Focus on Art is made possible by Denbo's of Claremore, an official Rolex jeweler offering a selection of diamonds, men's and women's jewelry and watches, china, and figurines. Open 9 to 6 Mondays through Saturdays, Denbo's is located at the corner of historic Route 66 and Will Rogers Boulevard in Claremore. RSC-TV thanks Denbo's for their support of Focus on Art and public television programming.
Focus on Art. A personal visit with the artists, museum curators, and gallery directors of Northeastern Oklahoma. A presentation of the Rogers State College Art Department.
When men speak of great artists of the Western world, Leonardo da Vinci is always listed among the greatest. And yet when we search for works by this great man, we will find less than 20 in existence. Works few in number, but remarkable achievements that have been the benchmark for Western artists during the last 500 years. Leonardo's Last Supper is the world's best known painting with a Christian subject. Picking the moment after Christ has just said, "One of you shall betray me," the painting is a fury of juxtaposed psychological responses. The calmness and reconciliation of Christ, the fearfulness of a guilt-ridden Judas, the innocence of St. Philip. Emotions that are felt through every movement of hand and head and torso. The image has been and continues to be the Last Supper for millions upon millions of people, and it is a masterpiece that was falling off the wall before it was ever completed. The mystical, elusive Mona Lisa emerges from the rocks and haze of a deep, aerial perspective space through subtle variations in light and shadow. The enigmatic face has captured the imagination of scholars for years, and may be, in actuality, Leonardo's greatest practical joke, a self-portrait. The Madonna of the Rocks, National Gallery, London, is a breathtakingly beautiful composition of Madonna, Christ, and St. John, accompanied by an angel. Christ blesses, St. John worships, and Mary the loving mother protects. Once again, the figures emerge from the background as Leonardo demonstrates his profound understanding of chiaroscuro. And so it goes, accolade heaped upon accolade as art historians pour through the short list of immensely powerful paintings by Leonardo. But to end one's understanding of Leonardo with the paintings alone would be to see only one facet of a marvelously faceted personality. No man in recorded history has exemplified the inventive capacity of mankind more fully than Leonardo. He investigated virtually every field of science and recorded his observations in thousands of sketches and notes. We still have over 4,000 pages from his notebooks. Papers which contain practical solutions to specific problems of his day and also envision such future possibilities as flying machines, automobiles, and automation. No field of endeavor was too small to excite his interest, none too large to smother his spark. Tonight we look at models made by 20th century man based on ideas found in Leonardo's sketchbooks. Hopefully this program will give us a brief indication of the extraordinary range of Leonardo's interest and investigations.
Welcome once again to Focus on Art. I'm your host, Barbara Cohen-Ayer, and delighted you're with us again this evening. We're at the Bartlesville Museum in the Price Tower for a wonderful exhibit of designs by Leonardo da Vinci, and my guest is Barbara Hallenstein. Barbara, welcome to Focus on Art.
Thank you very much, Barbara. I'm delighted to be here, and I'm glad that you're here to see our exhibit.
Well, we're certainly excited about the opportunity to see these models of designs that were conceived 500 years ago by that master of the High Renaissance. I think it's amazing that they are so modern, are so 20th century in concept.
That's right. Leonardo was remarkable. Not only was he an historical figure of great importance, but he's also renowned for his scientific discoveries and his wonderful artistic talent. So we feel that this show is representative of many aspects of the kind of exhibits that we like to bring to Bartlesville and will appeal to people of all ages.
Are you having a great response? I'm sure you are, from teachers and parents and adults as well.
So far, we're delighted with the response, and we have in the planned ahead and organized workshops for teachers so that they could be prepared to bring their students to the exhibit. And we've scheduled all of the sixth grade elementary students, and then many of the other high school science teachers, art teachers, and elementary school classes have also scheduled special visits to the exhibit.
And exactly what are they going to see when they get here?
They're going to see a wonderful range of creative imagination that has been brought to life in some wonderful realistic scale models that were built to exact detail from the notebooks that Leonardo created when he throughout his lifetime.
Well, they're just wonderful. And who created these models?
They were created by an Italian named Dr. Roberto Gratelli. And actually, he has been making models since the 1930s. He is still alive. I'm not sure how active he is right now, but he has been up to the very last few years.
Super. Well, let's talk just a little bit about the help you had in getting the exhibit to Bartlesville.
Yes, well, we are a new organization, and this is our first traveling exhibit, and so we are very appreciative of having some financial assistance from the State Arts Council of Oklahoma and also from our local Allied Arts and Humanities Council. That has really made things easier for us.
The exhibit is also sponsored by IBM, is that right?
IBM owns the exhibit, but actually is being managed now by the Science and Technology Foundation in Washington. So they don't really sponsor it, but they own it. IBM does.
Okay. Well, I just want to be sure and give everybody their proper credit. Okay, now are you going to take us through the exhibit, or are we going to have another host?
No. We have a specialist. We're very happy to have on our Board of Trustees someone that knows how to do things such as this to put our exhibits together so that they can be viewed by the public. Jerry Hastings, I'd like to introduce him to you because he worked for many, many days putting this exhibit together so that it everything works and everything looks wonderful.
Good evening, Barbara. I wish Leonardo had been here to help me put these things together.
I bet so. Well, Jerry, I think everybody's really excited about the opportunity to see the models, so let's just begin our tour.
Okay, let's start.
Jerry, let's begin here with mobile warfare.
This was Leonardo's concept of a military tank. It was human-powered, and there were breech-loading cannons, and the conical shape was meant to deflect cannonballs.
And so the soldiers were actually on the inside?
Yes, all on the inside.
Mm-hmm. And powering that by hand?
Powering by hand, yes. And really, the tank concept wasn't really used extensively until World War I.
So that he was only 400 years,
400 years ahead of his time.
Right. Now, as we have visitors to the museum, they can actually make this model work.
Yes, it's a hands-on exhibit.
One other thing we might mention here, of course, is the fact that we have a man that we know primarily as an artist who's also a military designer.
Mm-hmm. I think being an artist also helped him conceive a lot of these ideas. Most scientists take notes and engineers, but most of them can't draw. But the ability to draw, I think, really aided Leonardo.
And he certainly becomes then the person we think of as the Renaissance man. Absolutely. Okay, what should we see next?
I think probably go to the rotating bridge is probably the most interesting.
Okay.
Item next.
Bridge engineering. That's a new subject, Jerry.
Yes, this goes back to the warfare thing when the city-states were attacked. Leonardo developed this rotating bridge that actually would move out of the way if the enemy battalions would approach. Also, it could be used for river traffic, though.
So it's the early drawbridge, except instead of going it swings over to the side.
True.
Well, I think I've seen bridges like that in some of the eastern waterways that we're using today, where the bridge actually swings over to the side.
Really, the engineering principle, I think, would it be cheaper to come to the side than it would be overhead, because you have to clear the electric lines and so on.
And how did we swing the bridge over? Was this man-powered?
This was man-powered. Actually, this winch turned, and there was a winch on the other side that actually brought the bridge back into place.
Leonardo managed to cover all the angles.
Yeah, he pretty well thought out all of his designs, I think.
Well, Jerry, here we are at another exhibit that deals with weapons development.
This is a model of a triple-tier machine gun, and there were 11 cannons in each tier, and after one fired, that it would revolve, and the next tier would come up, and while the others were cooling, they could reload the third tier. And I don't think it was ever practically used, or as far as we know, but...
A little problem with recoil?
Yeah, a little problem with recoil, probably with 11 cannons firing at once.
And what size cannonballs are we talking about there?
Now that, I don't know.
He didn't specify.
No, he didn't specify the, in his sketch, the size of the cannonballs.
Well, Jerry, we certainly see the versatility of Leonardo as we come to this next exhibit, which is dealing with friction and speed.
Well, Leonardo was constantly thinking of ways to improve on industrial problems, and this was a roller bearing concept that he came up with to reduce the friction on a loaded wagon when the wheels turn. The wheels would actually turn just as easy loaded as they would empty. And this was a variable speed drive over next to this, and he came up with a conical gear and three gears, and he found that he could vary the speed, and of course that's used in present-day automobiles, like a differential automobile.
So we have basically a three-speed gear shift. Is this what this basically does for us? I wonder if we could have had an automobile today if we hadn't had Leonardo da Vinci.
I wonder sometimes about a lot of things, that, like tanks and helicopters and things like that. Really, you wonder when they would have been invented.
And of course, that's a wonderful hands-on part of the exhibit, too. Mm-hmm. Our next exhibit is entitled Industrial Engineering, and we have a couple of kind of widely varied exhibits on this particular stand.
Three centuries before the Industrial Revolution, Leonardo came up with a combination of gears to amplify power in material handling. He also developed clocks. He was probably the father of automation. Developed clocks that would run machinery, that were some of the time-consuming tasks, that like screw cut, wire cutting and things like that. And these clocks would cut off and stop the thing.
Where would you go from those inside gears? Would they then be attached to some kind of turning pipe that would drive a piece of machinery at a different rate of speed? Is that what the purpose of
that
is?
Yeah, that's really what the principle is. It actually amplifies the power, and it also works in the automobile the same way. The transmission amplifies the power of the engine. And this is also a principle used in clocks, too. This is a wire testing device. It tests the tensile strength of the wire, and sand came down into the basket, and he could tell by how much sand to determine the tensile strength of the wire.
Our next exhibit simply says distance. Now, what was Leonardo doing with distance?
This was a device for measuring distance traveled, and Leonardo's odometer was actually a simplification of an earlier Roman machine. And for each revolution of the wheel, the gears would turn and a pellet would drop, and they could tell by the number of pellets how far they had traveled. Offensive warfare. This was a scaling ladder that Leonardo had devised to scale the walls of the fortresses when they attacked them. And it's gear operated. And it's also similar to some of the firefighting apparatus that we use in today's equipment.
I guess as we look at these things, we can't forget that when you're thinking about 16th century Italy, you're thinking about almost constant warfare.
Yeah, the city-states actually were at war with each other constantly. And Leonardo really didn't believe in warfare, but they had to protect themselves, I guess.
Absolutely, and of course every city had a wall around it, so a scaling ladder like this would be a very important piece of equipment for an attacking army. I don't think anything has caught the imagination of people in general to any greater degree than the flying machines that Leonardo developed, and you're standing right under one, so let's talk about the flying machines.
Well, Leonardo made many unsuccessful attempts to design a flying machine, and this is one. And it was operated by the legs and the feet of the flyer. And as far as we know, no model ever existed that he actually did. These were still just concepts.
And what would happen when you pushed with your legs and feet? Did the wings flap?
The wings would flap, just like a bird. And he mentioned in his notes that a bird was really a study of mathematics. The way the wings operated and everything, and he applied it to his flying machine.
That's really amazing. Now, how about the other one? That's really more of a parachute,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it's a parachute, and of course, except it for the triangular shape, of course, the parachute's being used today, and it was very practical. Leonardo said to take linen and actually fill it with starch to fill all the porous surfaces, make it hold the air better. He said that a person could throw himself down from any great height and not sustain injury.
Okay, Jerry, our next kiosk has the title Measurement. What kind of measurements was Leonardo interested in doing?
In this case, Leonardo was interested in measuring the humidity in the air, and the cotton would attract moisture, and he'd have a counterbalance weight to determine how much humidity there was in the air. The device would measure the wind velocity, and it was marked in increments to determine the wind velocity. The other one is called an inclinometer, and it was a plumb bob, and you could tell whether something was square or tilted.
It's just amazing to me how I could have so many different interests in so many different things. Mm-hmm. Okay, Jerry, our next exhibit is dealing with machine tools.
Yeah, this particular item is a screw cutting machine, and Leonardo realized very early that uniformity in parts was very necessary for the machinery that he was devising and coming up with. And he was probably the father of automation because he actually devised clocks that would operate this machinery and do it over a long period of time.
Now how does this work? The outside screws...
Actually they guide the cutter so that they don't get them out of uniformity. It guides the entire...
And so you're actually making one screw at a time, and it's the middle screw
that's actually being cut.
Mm-hmm. And we're once again here probably at least 200 or 300 years before this machine became a reality.
True. Mm-hmm. This exhibit is about naval engineering. Leonardo developed this paddle wheel principle 3 centuries before the paddle wheel steam-powered, paddle wheeled steamboats of that we know about now were invented. And this particular model is hand-powered, and I'll operate the paddle.
Well, that works on the very same principle as paddle boats the kids use at the lake.
True.
Now, I wonder if he intended that to be pedaled by one person with a foot on each pedal, like the children's paddle boats that we're familiar with.
Probably, but I don't think it ever would work. Actual models were built, or it was just a theory again in his notebook.
We have other designs that Leonardo created dealing with naval engineering. Let's talk about a couple of those.
Okay, this happens to be a model of a double-hull ship, a design he came up with, so that if the ship ran aground and the outside was broken into, it would still float. And this is applicable to today. We're talking about tankers with double hulls to protect against leaking oil into the ocean. And this design is actually two different designs, one on each side, two different shapes of the hull. And present-day battleships actually are this shape now.
Did Leonardo feel that those particular shapes would cut through the water with
yes.
less resistance? Is that the reason for those?
He studied fishes and made his designs from the shape of fishes, and that's how he came up with this concept. He said through the study of nature, if we would just observe, that we could break down the principles of nature and understand our own world much better.
I also think it's just amazing that we're using that particular design today. We're using the one that's more logged out on the bottom, or the one that comes down to kind of a straighter point?
The one that's logged out on the bottom is actually the shape of our battleships. A cross-section through a battleship would show that same design, shape. This exhibit also deals with weapons development. This particular item is a steam gun that Leonardo devised. And this compartment would hold live coals to keep the barrel red hot. And then the projectile would be in the barrel, and cold water would be applied at the rear, which would force the cannonball out. And it had a range of over 2 miles.
2 miles from a gun run by steam power. I wonder if we've ever actually built any cannons that are run by steam power like this.
Not to my knowledge. I don't know about steam power has been used for a lot of things, but I don't recollect anything to do with guns.
Well, it's certainly an ingenious idea.
It certainly was, especially for the time.
Absolutely. You know, it's amazing if you could get that far with steam power driving a cannonball, that he didn't come up with the idea for the steam engine.
True.
XON TV 35 program guide this month. It's the design for the helicopter.
Yes, Leonardo was inspired by a Chinese toy, and he was always interested in the spiral, even in studying seashells and things like that, and this probably heralds the modern helicopter design.
And exactly how is this supposed to work?
Actually, it was human-powered, and the men were to turn the turnstile and actually power the corkscrew into the air. And it would be interesting to see a model actually built and flying.
If you got a little bit tired walking, you'd be in real trouble, right?
You better have one of his parachutes.
That's right. Okay. Well, this is probably the most futuristic drawing that we have from the sketchbooks. Would you agree with that?
I think so. I think it really is. It's an amazing concept. To think 500 years ago a man could conceive of something like a helicopter. It makes you wonder.
I guess it makes us all wonder if we really took our time and stopped and observed closely what mankind would really be able to do.
True. Yeah, Leonardo is a good example of a man that just went into about 100 different occupations at once almost.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Jerry, it was a wonderful tour, and we certainly appreciate your taking us through. And Barb, we appreciate your being here for Focus on Art. And we just wish the Bartlesville Museum in the Price Tower the very best with this exhibit and upcoming exhibit. For those of you at home, I hope you have an opportunity to be in Bartlesville. You'll really miss a grand show if you miss this one. Until next time, this is your host, Barbara Cohenour, wishing you a most pleasant good evening.
Focus on Art is made possible by Denbo's of Claremore, an official Rolex jeweler offering a selection of diamonds, men's and women's jewelry and watches, china, and figurines. Open 9 to 6 Mondays through Saturdays, Denbo's is located at the corner of historic Route 66 and Will Rogers Boulevard in Claremore. RSC-TV thanks Denbo's for their support of Focus on Art and public television programming.
RSC-TV, KRSC, Claremore.